Okay, so let's start. Okay, so first of all, for those who are not physically present in the room, so we'd like to apologize. There is some technological issue today at ICTP. So unfortunately, I've been told by the IT staff that you cannot be here on Zoom. So it will be recorded, and you will watch this at a later stage. And if you have questions, you can, of course, email me, and I try to answer as well as possible. Or you can ask during the next lecture or so on. OK, so last time we finished, kind of we looked at Möbius transformations, and we were talking about the Riemann sphere a lot in the past two lectures. And now we start lecture 7, which will deal with a completely new topic, because now we start with a topic that we cannot avoid sooner or later, right? We start with complex integration. Because in complex analysis, if you want to go deeper, sooner or later you will have to deal with this topic of integration. Okay, so today, let me put it on the board. Today we will talk about complex integration, which is, of course, a rather huge topic that could occupy us for a rather long time. So it's an important tool to prove deeper results in complex analysis. So what do we do? So basically, let me draw a picture. Of course, if you have real analysis, you integrate along the real axis. So you integrate along paths, so to speak, which is exactly a subset, maybe, of the real axis. So if you do complex analysis, on the other hand, then an integral in complex analysis is always a path integral, of course. And what you integrate over will then be some curve, and possibly a rather complicated curve could be something like this. So, or it could actually be something also with corners, right? So it could be something that has some corner like that as well. And in particular, it has self-intersections, which could also be seen as a type of corner, right? Because here you get these sharp corners from the intersection. Okay, so the first point to make is that the basic one is we integrate along paths, okay? So we integrate along paths. And then I should tell you which kind of path we are dealing with. What we are talking about. So paths, or sometimes you call them arcs or curves, or even contours is a common name for all these things. So it's a little bit confusing sometimes with terminology, exactly what is meant by a curve, exactly what is meant by a path, and so on, what is meant even by a region or domain, or you have all these questions, right? And typically, it's even more confusing because, depending on which book you pick up, we do it in a different degree of generality. And also, in this course, we will not go through the maximal generality, but we will rather try to understand just what is happening. And the generality that we will want to work with here is the generality that allows at least to consider curves with self-intersections. All right, so we would like to be able to integrate along, say, a rectangle, so something that has a corner or several corners, and we'd also want to be able to integrate along something with self-intersections. And this means that we need to allow something which is piecewise smooth, but not necessarily smooth at exactly every point, so only piecewise smooth, but at least continuous. So this will be the regularity that we deal with in this course. Then if you go into the literature, you can push this into something called rectifiable curves, which is just, you know, trying to do this exercise of pushing the regularity as much as you can, right? But we don't care particularly about this in this course, even though it's a topic that you are very free to explore on your own afterwards, right? But it's key that we don't just work with smooth. So we need at least piecewise smooth to be able to do really interesting things. So contours that are piecewise smooth or piecewise actually differentiable is enough. So we need to be able typically to take one derivative, piecewise differentiable and continuous. Okay, so this is the regularity in this course. And just the warning is that not the optimal regularity, okay? Meaning that sometimes you can push this even further. But we will not go so much into that in this course. Okay, so the first thing that we need to do is, I mean, and of course, if you have such a curve, then just to go in through the overview picture here, is that you can always write this as a sum of these parts that are not intersecting. Okay, and then you can integrate along each of these parts separately and then sum them together. So really, to be able to deal with something like this, it's enough to be able to deal with something like that, but with a sharp corner here. So which is then continuous here, but not differentiable. OK, so let's recall path integrals now in the context of complex analysis. And by the way, a real integral is always a special case of a complex integral, which is something which is very useful, which some of you surely know. It's a very classic exercise in complex analysis to compute real integrals using complex analysis. And this is precisely because you can deal with complicated paths, but in particular, you can just integrate along the real line or subsets of the real line. OK, so suppose that A, this is an open subset, and F from A into C is holomorphic. Then we say that a smooth, for example, a smooth path. So what is a smooth path? The smooth path, we actually touched upon this a little bit when I had to recall some differential geometric notions in lecture 5, I think. But we talked about what is a curve, and I said a curve is the map and not its image, right? So a smooth path is a smooth map. And I put smooth within parentheses because you can replace it with something else like differentiable or continuous or so on, and you will get the same thing. So a continuous path would be a continuous map and so on, such that, I mean, a map gamma that goes from some interval AB in the real line into this set A, this subset of C, which maps simply T to gamma of t. And we make this remark that the path is the map and not the image, OK? As we recall, so a path is a map and not its image. Again, by this, I mean that it's not the figure that I draw on the board, but it's actually all that's the information that's contained also in the parametrization. So in particular, we have, thanks to this parametrization, it's always something. So it could be something like this. This is gamma of A. This is gamma of B. And this will mean that the curve, in this case, is directed, right? It has an orientation. So it goes from gamma of A to gamma of B. And if I looked at the curve, so this is the curve gamma. So gamma of t is somewhere here for t between A and B. And if I look at the at this curve here that goes in the other direction, then this is the curve that I call minus gamma. This is the opposite path or opposite curve. And minus gamma is not considered to be the same one as gamma. And in particular, this is important because you know that even if you think back to real analysis, if you integrate from A to B or from B to A, it's not the same result. But in fact, the result going from B to A would be minus the result going from A to B. And it's going to be the same in complex analysis, but the result integrating here is minus the result integrating in the other direction. OK, so these two are not the same. They're not the same. OK, and even if you have different parameterizations, strictly speaking, they are not the same. If you sort of go through this path very fast or very slowly or with different parameterizations, they are considered to be different. On the other hand, this point is less important because the integrals will turn out to be equivalent under the choice of parameterization, considering that you keep the orientation when you change the parameterization. Okay? So now, how do we define the integral? So we want to define the integral of f of z dz along this curve gamma. So what is now the definition of such an integral? So by definition, it will be the following. So we will integrate f of gamma of t, but then using the chain rule, we also need this gamma prime of t dt. OK, so this is the definition of this integral. Okay. This is the very basic thing. So every time, I mean, this you can always go back to. What does it mean to integrate along a complex curve, a complex function? It means exactly this. And now, of course, these are functions of t, a real variable. And these integration bounds are real numbers. So now you just know how to do this from calculus, right? So we will see examples in a second. So let's just go to the next step. So if, so the point is you can add curves. You can add paths together. So is it clear for everyone what would it mean to add a path to another path? Maybe with a non-technical reply. So OK, you have the parameterizations and so on. But adding a path to another path, it means that you first go through one of them, and then you continue through the next one. Right? So if I have a path gamma 1, and then I have a path gamma 2, so of course, you can only do this if the endpoint coincides with the starting point of the next one. But then gamma 1 plus gamma 2 will be this whole curve going through. And so if I add all these curves together, then I will define that the integral of gamma here, of f of z dz will be the sum of the integrals along gamma I of f of z dz. So if I have several pieces, OK, it's very natural. You just integrate along each piece separately, and then you add them up. OK? So you have this, this relation. Yes? Wait, sorry, this? Yeah, it's a concatenation of two paths, yeah. Different when adding. So what do you think it should be? So what should it be, you say? Sorry?
Path can be
Okay, so I'm not sure. So I mean, the point.
So I'm not sure if I understand exactly what you are saying necessarily, but the point, of course, is that if you have such a thing, then you want to consider this to be the sum of several different things. Okay. Yeah, we can discuss it later. Okay, yeah, why not? We can check here in the book what it says if you want to see. Maybe you can explain to me your point later. Okay, so. Let's see here, hang on. So. No, but I really think, I mean, so I'm not sure what you are, I'm not sure what you want it to be instead, actually, this thing. So I really think it's this thing, I mean, with gamma 1, oops, it goes from some doesn't matter. I mean, it's a bit technical to write down, so I don't want to write down all the subdivision of the intervals and so on. But okay, I really think it's this concatenation. Let me just write down the example of the opposite path. Well, okay, let me write. So this is independent. So this definition here. So okay, forgetting about this for a moment. So this is independent of the choice of parametrization, but up to changing the orientation. And by this, I will mean, for example, the opposite path, this thing I told you about. So for example, the opposite path the opposite path will be this minus gamma that goes from minus b minus a in t. Okay, and it goes to gamma of minus t. So this would mean to take this path gamma and go in the other direction. Okay, so this one would be an example of something which is not independent under the change of parametrization. If you go from the endpoints to the starting points, so to speak. So what I mean, so more precisely, here comes the precise statement. So if t, so you have some a tilde b tilde, and a function t that goes from here to ab, which is where our path is defined. So this is an increasing function. And this is the key word here. So it's an increasing function, smooth function, let's say. OK, so it's an increasing smooth function. Then the integral along this path gamma composed with t, this new orientation here, of f of z dz is equal to the integral of gamma f of z dz. OK, and why not, you know, go into very quickly why this is true? OK, so the proof is that we look at, okay, so we have this a tilde, b tilde, a, b, and then we go into this set A, this subset of C, and we can call this old path gamma composed with this change of parametrization, we call it gamma tilde. OK, and this thing, sorry, come on, let me write it here.
And this one sends tau to t of tau, which sends it to gamma of t of tau. OK, so then what we do is that the integral of this gamma, so we just write down basically what this means by the definition. So it could be a small, just getting used to how this works. So this is the integral from A to B of f of gamma of t, gamma prime of t of tau, and t, so gamma prime, because here I didn't put the tau yet, so it's this by definition. But now if I remember that t depends on tau, then I can just do very standard things using the chain rule. So by the chain rule, this is equal to the integral going from A tilde to B tilde of f of gamma of t of tau times gamma prime of t of tau times t prime of gamma d tau. Okay, where this whole thing here is just d dt of gamma of t of tau, right? So this is why this is true. And this is, again, by definition. So these two are by definition. So by definition, this is equal to the integral along gamma tilde of f of z dz. Now, the question, where did we use the fact that it was increasing, this parameterization? So I said this is very important. I said if we have the opposite path, then it doesn't work. So I should have used it somewhere. Sorry, it's very hard to hear in this room with the fans. Yeah. Then we will have what? Sorry, I'm deaf.
A negative sign.
Then we'll have a negative sign, because I used it here, right? That it goes when, otherwise, I mean, how do I know that it goes from A tilde to B tilde and not the other way around? Right? Exactly. So there's where I use the increasing sign. So this is a simple application of a chain rule. We get that it's independent of the parameterization. And again, just we note, so in general, we have, for instance, we can have changes of sign. And the easiest example of this is, again, this opposite path minus gamma, which yields this. Now, let's do some examples. OK, any questions, by the way, about this so far, other than the one about the sum? OK, so some examples. So we have the first example is if we take f of z is equal to 1 over z, and we consider this on c star, which, well, I don't know if you saw this notation a lot in your lives, but c star is very standard for c minus 0, of course, in mathematics. So it means, OK, the function 1 over z, it just had a problem in 0, so we remove it, and it is analytic now on this domain A, which is open. So this is open. And f is analytic, holomorphic on A. So far, so good. Then we take gamma to be the path that goes from 0, 1 into A, defined by, no, sorry, I wanted it apparently. Of course, there are many ways of choosing parameterizations. I will follow my notes just in case. Easier not to get lost. So R is some fixed positive number, and you just consider this path. So of course, what is this path? It is just the circle of radius R. And it's important that we also have a natural direction, right? So which one is the direction on this? So it's counterclockwise. That's what you're doing. It's correct. So it's counterclockwise. And counterclockwise is what's usually called positive orientation, just as a small remark. OK, and I believe that we choose this to be positive. I mean, the reason why this is the convention in the literature, I would say, is because multiplication by I goes actually counterclockwise instead of clockwise. So it might seem like you wanted this to be negative, but somehow positive orientation, the most natural direction, is counterclockwise in complex analysis. OK, and of course, it's a closed path. So it's a closed path. So what does it mean to be closed? Well, it means, of course, that gamma of 0 is equal to gamma of 2 pi. In general definition, gamma of A is equal to gamma of B. So the endpoints coincide of this path. By the way, so if I had taken gamma going from 0 to 3 pi, and then I draw the picture, my picture would probably still look like this, right? But instead of going around exactly once, I go around a lap and a half. Is this a closed path? So then it's not a closed path anymore, even though it looks like the picture is still the same. And you'd say, oh, it looks closed, but it's not, because I stop here, and I started here. And the integral will no longer be 0 around this thing. I mean, it wasn't 0 anyway, but in this particular example. But if you took a holomorphic function everywhere here. OK, so that was just a remark. Now, we want to compute this integral of f of z along this gamma. So we have gamma of t, which is r e to the i t. Means that we just very easily compute the derivative in t. The only difference is I got an I here. And then the integral of gamma of f of z dz is then equal to the integral going from 0 to 2 pi of f of gamma of t. So f of gamma of t is 1 over r e to the it times gamma prime of t, so times r I e to the it dt. Now, almost everything cancels, right? But there is this little I, which I now put on the outside. So this is equal to actually 2 pi I. And you see, if I put 3 pi here instead, it would have been 3 pi I. And it just goes to show that it, you know, the picture can be the same, but the results for the integral can be different, which is why really the map is what matters and not the image. Okay, so this is equal to 2 pi I. So this is a very important example, as you will see soon. Note in particular that the result is independent of the radius of this circle that they go around. So the result is independent of R. So this is going to be a very typical thing, typical phenomenon that you see later. OK, a second very important class of examples will be all of the functions that has a primitive. OK, so primitive meaning an antiderivative. So this was example one. Now, example two will be, suppose that f is the function that goes from A into C. So A is some open set. Okay, A is some open subset. So it's not the same as here, right? So I'm not saying it's C star. So this is a holomorphic. And in particular, holomorphic means that we can differentiate infinitely many times, but in particular, we can differentiate once. And I am allowed to define now my small f to be equal to F prime, capital F prime. Okay, so it means that capital F is the primitive function of small f, okay? Now, then what happens? Then for any smooth path, like this, we can compute the integral. And what is it? Note, by the way, that when I write down this definition, I use that gamma is smooth, right? Because I take gamma prime of the, I mean, I use that it's differentiable anyway. But then, of course, if you have just one corner, then this has measure zero in some sense. I mean, morally, this is what's happening. And then you can add up. So just piecewise smooth will be enough to get the integral to be independent of this thing. Okay, so it's equal to this by definition from A to B. But this, what is this? Well, it's equal to exactly. So this is equal to this, of course. This is the derivative of this function. And okay, so the point that I want to get across is that it's equal to f of this. So again now, so again, this is a real integral, right? So we have a fundamental theorem of calculus. And so the point is we want to know that this one has an antiderivative. So then since it has an antiderivative, then we know that we compute it like this. And this is by the fundamental theorem of calculus. Okay, but what is this, by the way? So, okay, in general, it can be anything, but very often we'll be interested in closed paths. So as a particular corollary of this, we see that if our path is closed, then, and there exists a primitive, then the integral has to be zero. So let me write this corollary here. So if f has a primitive and gamma is closed, then the integral of f of z dz has to be 0. OK, because gamma of A is equal to gamma of B. So of course, f of gamma of B is equal to f of gamma of A. Okay, so now a nice question for you here. Put it in red. So from one, from this first part of the, this first example, f of z is 1 over z. Combined, of course, with what we learned in example two. What can we say about primitives? Are you OK with this terminology, by the way? Did you call it primitives or antiderivatives when you went to school, or both? Doesn't matter. Antiderivative? OK. So this is the same thing, anyway, for me, OK? Primitive and antiderivative. So what can we say about antiderivatives of this function f of z is equal to 1 over z? On C.
Sorry, on system. So the function that we just studied here, it doesn't have an antiderivative. Okay, why? Exactly. So putting the two examples together, okay, so for the people not hearing, maybe cannot hear the answer. So the answer was that because this integral is not zero, there can be no antiderivative. So what you did correctly is that you put the two examples together. You said that, okay, if there exists an antiderivative, then the integral around such a closed curve would have to be zero. By the other example. But the integral, as we just saw, is not zero, so there can be no antiderivative. Okay, so the answer so it's quite beautiful, actually, I think, you know, because we could look all day for an antiderivative, we could look all our lives for an antiderivative, but we could never say that we tried all analytic functions if we just tried stupidly. But here we have a nice argument for the non-existence of such antiderivatives. So there is no analytic, let me write it like this, there is no analytic function on C star with derivative 1 over z. So this is very nice. On the other hand, what do we do? I mean, but there is such a function. So we know that there are such functions on some domains on the complex plane, right? So for example, what? Sorry?
Log of z.
Log of z, exactly. So we know that the logarithm is the one who's supposed to be the primitive of this one. But it can only be defined on if we take a branch cut, going all the way to infinity. The problem with this was that we were on C star, so it allowed for curves to wind around zero. And that's exactly what gives this behavior that we have here. So there's such a function, log on this standard branch cut or other branch cuts, okay, or also okay. So, of course, we already talked about this, so I only have to write that and you know what I mean, right? We can take any branch, any line that goes out to infinity, and this will give a version of log. If I take this one, it's the principal branch of a logarithm. But on all of C star, it is not possible for this reason, putting together these two examples. Now, these two examples are very nice because, okay, first of all, we had this nice remark, but we're not done even there. But it also illustrates the important concept of a winding number. Okay, so generalizing example one, we get the concept called winding numbers. Winding numbers. Okay, so what is this? So to define it, so what it means morally will be how many, if you have a curve, how many times does it turn around a certain point? So if you have a circle, of course, it's very easy, okay, it turns a certain number of times around the origin, maybe around any other point inside the circle or inside this thing. But if I have these more complicated curves that I drew in the beginning, you know, something that self-intersects and it goes around and so on and so forth, how many times does it wind around a certain point? And what is its relation to these integrals? And the very nice thing is that you can somehow capture it using these integrals that are of a form 1 over z minus the point that you want to know if it winds around. Okay, so consider, I will show you, explain now what it means.
So consider gamma going from 0, 1 into star. Okay. That maps t to e to the 2 pi I n t. Okay. So this n is important, where n is some integer. It could be positive, could be negative. Okay. For some integer. Then, okay, so this is, of course, what I call gamma of t. Okay. The image of n gamma prime of t is equal to 2 pi I n e to the 2 pi I n t. Okay, so all that's up there comes down. And this integral along gamma of some function, no, sorry, not some function. Not just any function, of course. So the integral of dz over z is equal to the integral from 0, 1 of 2 pi I n e to the 2 pi I n t divided by e to the 2 pi I n t. Dt, which is equal to 2 pi I n. Okay, so we pick up this n here, okay? And by the way, I could do the exactly, here it's a circle around 0, right? Around the origin, but if I put a circle with center A, then I would have to look at z minus A here, and it would give exactly the same thing. Okay, so the circle around, if I put, I mean, A or some W or something, I don't know which one we prefer, then it would be W plus this thing here. And then I would have to take Z minus W here, and it gives exactly the same computation. OK. Now this is a remark. You can check for yourselves. So now definition. Oh, is it working? The definition of a winding number is the following. So n here is the winding number right?
The password is
8. Ah, okay. Yes. It's the winding number. Can you hear me? So the people online, if you can hear me, please write something or.
Yes, we can hear.
OK. Thank you. OK, so you haven't been here. I don't know if someone told you that there were these technical issues, that all the Zoom servers were down. So I apologize for that. Therefore, so far, we have everything recorded, but we were told to start like this anyway. So OK, now you are joining us in the middle. So we've been talking about complex integration. And we've been defining path integrals so far. And now I just started discussing the winding number. So I apologize for the fact that you are now not completely up to speed with what we are doing, right? But so I was just defining the winding number of a path. So OK, I'm sorry, but you know, we are halfway through the lecture. The best solution should be that you try to catch up later. So I'm really sorry about this technical issue. So it was the internet in the whole building that was down. Does that sound OK for you guys online, if we just keep going and then you can try to catch up?
Yes.
Yeah, it's not ideal at all. Yeah, but it's the best in an unfortunate situation, I guess. And then as I said on the recording, as I explained to you guys in the beginning, even though you weren't here, you're very free to ask me questions. Once you watch the recording, you can send me email and so on. So it will be almost as if you were here. Okay, so this is, let's remove this word definition. So let me just, because this is still my explanation. So n is here the winding number of gamma with respect to z equals 0. Now the formal definition, which is just slightly more general, is the following. So the winding number of a continuous Let me just do this. So of a curve, gamma around A, which is a point, around a point, z equals A, is defined by the following formula. So can you see here? Now I'm behind the thing. You cannot see there. So is defined by, let us go all the way over here. Okay, so there are two things in the winding number. Okay, so there's the curve, which should be sufficiently regular in a suitable sense. And then there's the point around which we want to find out how many times it winds around, right? So the notation for the winding number is n of gamma a. So n just mimicking the notation, okay, that I used there, pedagogically. And a is the point, and gamma is the curve. So it's defined as 1 over 2 pi I, the integral along gamma of dz over z minus a. So you see in particular that if we take a equal to 0, then you look at this example over here, then you see that when we computed this integral, we got 2 pi I n. So we just divide by 2 pi I, and we get this n, which is exactly the number of times that this path winds around 0. Because you see this 2 pi I, this path here, of course, it's characterized, so I never drew the picture. But of course, it winds n times. So it goes in this direction, and it goes n laps around the origin, right? And then the integral was 2 pi I n. So really, this n captures the number of times, and the general definition is that. OK, so winds n times around z equals 0. OK. So in general, we will consider, of course, more complicated curves like like this. We have some complicated curves, and we want to know how many times, positive or negative, by the way, because everything is oriented. So if you took a circle and went in the other direction, then you could wind minus 1, 2, 3 times around the origin. Now, in general, we might have such a curve, and we have a point. The point is in here, or the point is out here, and so on. And what is then the winding number? OK, and this is the kind of problem that we want to deal with. And now I want to establish a few simple properties about the winding number. So what do you think we can say about this winding number? For example, can it be, so we established it could be negative. But is it always an integer, for example? OK, so you believe it's always an integer. Yes, that's true. And this will be an exercise or a property that we will prove. And what if I take a point A here, and then I take another point B here? What would be the relation between the winding numbers around A and around B? If you can see this picture, they will be the same. And why will they be the same? I mean, you don't have to tell the proof, orally, but just morally speaking, intuitively speaking, what would be the reason? Exactly. So the sort of the hypothesis, so intuitively speaking, looking at this kind of pictures, you're saying that it should be always an integer. And if you take two points in the same connected component defined by the curve, so this is what we call it. You see the curve divides the plane into different connected components. And if you're in the same such connected component, then the winding number is always the same. Of course, if you jump over, then it might change in general. Okay, so let us prove one of these two things, and the other one I leave to your homework sheet. That's the plan. So proposition claim. Okay. So the part of a claim is that, so the one that I won't prove is that any curve like this actually partitions the plane into connected components. You know, these things sound completely simple, but then you have the Jordan curve theorem and so on. It turns out that in mathematics, you actually have to prove that if you have a curve, it separates the plane in, you know, an inside and an outside and all these things, right? So this is sort of slightly outside of the scope of the course. So the first part here is that it's the claim part. So any curve gamma partitions the plane. So the plane R2, the plane, the complex plane, into connected components into connected regions, I can call them, or components. Sorry? If we need gamma to be closed, yeah, sure. So if you have this, then it doesn't define, I mean, maybe it's still true. Technically, it's true. It divides it into just one big region, I guess. But yeah, I'm talking more specifically about closed curves now. Also because we're talking about the winding number. So if you have something that doesn't, that's not closed, then the winding number will just be zero, right? So interconnected regions. Okay, and the regions are open sets, of course. So that's the claim part. And now the thing that we will prove is the thing here. But now suppose that A and B are in the same such connected component or connected region. Defined by gamma, then the claim is that the winding number around A is equal to the winding number around B. OK, so the proof of this, I think, is quite nice, actually. And it uses the logarithm. Uses the logarithm. So the proof is the following. Because, of course, as often happens with statements in mathematics, this is sort of intuitively obvious, but how can you actually prove it? This is a different thing. So what we do, first let me draw a picture. So let's say that gamma is something like that, okay? And then I have a point A and a point B. And then I want to take the line, sorry, this is supposed to be a straight line, going from A to B. Okay, and I will denote this actually by A. So the line segment, so let me write the sentence. So without loss of generality, this is the claim. We may assume that the line segment, okay, so now we come to this line segment joining the points from A to B. I will just denote it like this. Even though now it's not, of course, the interval
it's not part of a real axis, but anyway, it's a sort of suggestive notation, right? It's that it means this. But not necessarily along the axis, but it can be in any direction, okay? So we may assume that the line segment is in the region. So in the region, so this is a picture of the one connected component, right, that I'm interested in. So if I had all of this, I'm now zooming in on just this. But now it looks like that. Okay. I draw it like that. And then I say that, okay, let me take the line segment going from A to B. Why can I do that? I say I do it without loss of generality. Of course, it's possible that maybe my B is hiding here and A is there, so when I take the line segment, it has to pass outside of the connected component. Exactly. Exactly, but I can always go there. So if I had my A being here and B being there, I could just go to an intermediary point here and an intermediary point there, C, and then I would say that, okay, with the same proof, then these two have the same winding number, and these two have the same winding number, so then in particular also these have the same winding number. So therefore, I claim that it suffices to assume that we have this picture, that we can just look at two points that are joined by a line inside. Okay? So of course, okay, and it can be several points, right? So you can just take a stack as many as you want, just a finite number. Yes?
Then I think
yeah, but in Rn, connected implies path connected. So this is a good remark. Because, I mean, connected and open implies path connected, but it's definitely open, right? But this is a very good remark. I even wanted to write this on the board, but I mean, I have it in my notes somewhere, this little comment. But let me write it now. So in Rn, connected and open implies path connected. OK. Exactly. So this is the remark. Now, okay, here. So now what do we do? Now we look at the image. So we take this picture. We look at the line from A to B. And we want to see where it is mapped under. So I mean, this is now, you know, where is this coming from, right? So now, all of a sudden, I'm writing down on the board a Möbius transformation, z minus a over z minus b. And the question is, what is the image of this line under this map? So I'll draw it in orange. So the claim is that actually the image, can you see it? The real line. All of the real line? Three?
Positive.
So when I did this in my notes, I got, when I did the computation, it became the negative one. So let us try to do it, but see, so, okay. I will draw what is in my notes. Okay, so this is the plane. Okay, this is zero here. So the image is this. Let us do the computation. So z I copy the computation. So z is equal to a plus b minus a times t, where t is in 0, 1. So this is a way to parameterize, right? When t equals 0, then I'm in A, and when t is equal to 1, then I'm in B. So this is a way to write down the line segment, AB. And t is a real number between 0 and 1.
So then I can write down what is z minus a over z minus b. So this is the key part then. And what I got when I did this, of course, it's possible that I made a sign error or something. But you can check this for me. Is it equal to that? And if it is, then it's equal to t over t minus 1, where t goes from 0 to 1, which means that this one is positive and this one is negative. So we will end up in the negative real axis, right? Does that sound fair? Anyway, so this shows how you're supposed to determine the image of this. You do this kind of thing, and then you determine, OK, for each value of t between 0 and 1, the image is this. And the image of this for t from 0 and 1 appears to me to be the negative real axis. OK? So what I drew here. And now, why did I do this? Well, now I can take the logarithm. So I can take even the principal branch of the logarithm, because this is precisely where it's defined, right? On c minus this branch cut. So with log, this takes me into the complex plane. OK, so this is going to be the image. So let me write in words what I did, or what I'm doing. OK, so what I'm saying is that, so the claim is that we can define, or that actually the principal branch log of a logarithm, of a complex logarithm, is analytic on C minus this line segment AB. So if I go here and I look at everything outside of this cut, then I mean, this composite function is what I mean, of course. So of a complex logarithm what I claim is that this log of z minus a over z minus b, sorry. So where log is the principal branch of the complex logarithm is analytic in sequential. So this is what I mean. Sorry about that. So OK, this composite function is analytic there. Of course, the principal branch of the logarithm is analytic here. But then we use the fact that we could determine the image here under this Möbius transform to see that this composite function is analytic where we want it to be. So this means now that we can take the differential here. So differentiating, what do we get? So we get 1 over z minus a minus 1 over z minus b, right? We differentiate this. And hence, this implies what? So this is an analytic function. So it implies that when I take the integral along gamma, or if I want, I can write it like that. So actually, what I want to compare in the end is the winding numbers. So the winding number is 2 pi I, around a is 2 pi I times this. And I want to compare it with 2 pi I times the following thing. So what I want is to compare these two integrals. We agree so far, right? So now if I do this, then the whole point is that this is actually equal to this log. So the point is that this function, this 1 over z minus a minus 1 over z minus b, now has a primitive. And since it has a primitive, which is given by this log, then this whole thing is equal to log of gamma of 1, so z is equal to gamma of 1, minus a over gamma of 1 minus b, minus log of gamma of 0 minus a over gamma of 0 minus b. And now if the curve is closed, this is equal to 0, because gamma of 1 is equal to gamma of 0. OK, and hence we conclude that the winding numbers are equal. OK, any questions about this proof? So of course, you start somehow backwards. The way it was presented here, you know, why would I start talking about all of this unless I had already realized I would finish with this kind of argument, right? So, but it's often like that. You present it kind of backwards, I guess. So the idea was, OK, I wanted to probably, if you found this yourself, you'd start by trying to compare these integrals, and you'd realize, it looks like they might be the derivative of the logarithm of z minus a over z minus b. But then you have to ask yourself, but can I actually differentiate this function in a suitable region? And then you have to check if it's actually differentiable. And then you do this thing. You look at the image of this kind of thing, and you realize, OK, at the complement of such a line, you have this argument. And then you can apply this. OK, and this proof used path connectedness, as you said. OK, so this was the remark. Now, to summarize, so now I'll just write down I guess three properties of a winding number that are useful, but this is the only one that I will prove today. So to summarize, so we can prove the following. Okay, so some of it we did, and some is an exercise. So one nice exercise is that this winding number is always an integer, as you said. Second property is that, so if I take the winding number of minus gamma around something, then what does it equal? Exactly, then it's minus n of gamma of a. So this is kind of easy property, I guess. And then you have this thing that we just proved, that n of gamma of a is constant on path connected so on connected component of. So when I write c minus the image of gamma like this, then of course, okay, this naturally has connected components. So this is a well-defined thing, talking about it like this. Okay, so this is what we just proved. So now, why did we talk about this winding number? So it's a very fascinating concept and everything. And okay, why not? Why would we not want to know how many times a curve winds around a point? You know, I don't know, is this very interesting or not? But the main reason right now for this course is that in order to formulate this Cauchy's theorem that you probably all heard about, and then Cauchy's integral formula, and so on and so forth, and actually many results for the rest of the course that follow then from these, you will need this winding number in the statement. So many integrals in complex analysis basically depend on how many times you wind around a certain point. Maybe this point is a singularity of your function, like 1 over z has a singularity, it has a pole in z equals 0, and then it matters for the integral how many times you actually turn around. And if it's a circle, then it's fair enough, but if you have a general curve, it's convenient that you can compute it in some way and not having to count and follow it around, because that's, of course, not possible in practice if it's a very complicated curve. So the point is that it's relevant for this theorem, for Cauchy's theorem, and all the theorems that follow from it. But in order to prove Cauchy's theorem, so I mean I can state it. What? So Cauchy's theorem. Well, actually, I cannot state it because I have to use this winding number to tell you what it means to be homologous to zero and so on and so forth. So the first thing I want to do is just to give a proof of the Cauchy's theorem for a disk. So it's a sort of preliminary version for a disk. Okay, so this is a preliminary version. And the general version will come at the beginning, first half, let's say, of next lecture, most likely. Okay? Depending on time. It comes right after it. But in order to discuss the more, I mean, the proof of this Cauchy's theorem is sort of legendary because it takes, you know, you can have quite complicated situation in the general case, but then the proof always goes by just reducing the proof to a simpler case, and then a simpler and simpler and simpler and simpler. And in the end, you've reduced to proving the theorem for a triangle, actually. And this is kind of always the idea. And in complex analysis courses, you usually do the theorem for a triangle, and this has some name. You know, it's someone's theorem. Someone proved it for the triangle, and then someone, I think, Goursat, so this is a second Goursat theorem in complex analysis, proved it then for a rectangle. And then you prove it for, you know, more and more complicated domains. And you had this whole history of this result. But so somehow, in order to prove these theorems, you want to start by the simple case, and then you want to build upwards towards the more complicated. So now we start with the following theorem, Cauchy's theorem for a disk. But this one is already quite general. I mean, you can already do quite a lot for this. So let gamma be a closed path. In the disk, and by the disk, I will mean the open unit disk. This is the open unit disk. Suppose, moreover, that f is an analytic function on the disk. And the claim is then that if I take the integral around this closed path gamma of f of z dz, then it's equal to 0. So this is the theorem that I think is very striking in the beginning when you start studying complex analysis. So I realize that most of you, if not all of you, have already seen a course in complex analysis before. So you're not exactly shocked by it anymore. But I think the first time maybe you saw it, it was shocking that these integrals are always zero, you know. And you had to think about it. Why can this really be the case? So I think, yeah, it took me a while. And then I remember still the first explanation I came up with to myself to try and explain why it should always be zero. And then I started thinking about this potential theory. Like, you know, in physics, which I don't know much about at all, you have, for example, the height function, right? So if you imagine that you're at home or you're here
And then you go for a run or for a walk or something, and maybe in the mountains, and you go up, and then you go down, and you always track, you know, the height difference that you go through your walk. So you go up, and then, okay, you gain an elevation of 200 meters, and then you go down again, maybe into a valley, and then you come back up. And then when you sum up all of this, plus to up to 100 meters down, 300 meters up, 150 meters, and so on, even though you go all the way around the world, when you sum up, as long as you come back home again, which means you went along a closed path, the net total of up and downs of this height change will be zero, right? So I remember still, and this was the explanation I came up with sort of for myself to try to understand this as a student, why it should be logical that you can do these things. And again, the difference, so I touched upon this in a different lecture, that if the difference in complex analysis is actually that you can take these complicated paths that go and do interesting things and then come back to the same point, whereas in real analysis, if you went somewhere and then came back, it would be a completely trivial path, right? You just move along this line and then you have to retrace your steps. But now you can go somewhere and come back without ever going back in your path, right? You can always see something new, and then you come back from another direction than the one you came from. Okay. So you can get these a priori strange results, but they are actually not that strange. And also you might know that if you talk to engineers, like electrical engineers, they use a lot of complex analysis precisely because this area of physics is about potentials and about this being like a zero-sum game in a certain sense. And so you have all these results. So the remark. So as you may have noticed, I'm sure you noticed, so I've stopped writing here precise regularity on the closed path. So the moral of the lectures is always, okay, assuming we have sufficient regularity to do whatever we need to do, because anyway, we're not going to discuss these rectifiable paths, which might be, you know, the state of the art in terms of regularity you can put on these. So on the other hand, we want, as I said in the beginning, to consider self-intersecting curves, which means that when I look at a connected component of something like the figure 8, I would like to be able to forget this one, but then I get this little corner here, so I just want it to be piecewise differentiable. So we allow for gamma to be piecewise differentiable. Yeah, okay. Sorry, I hear somebody. Yeah, piecewise, exactly. It means that you have isolated points, so to speak, where, there we go. Yeah, and it's measure zero in particular. Yes. OK, so we can start certainly the theorem, the proof of this theorem. We might not finish it, but we might finish halfway. And then I do the remaining part next time. So the proof so the proof goes by reducing again. So you have this general situation, and then I will reduce it to a triangle, actually, in the end. So this is the point. So the first step, the first small reduction, is assume without loss of generality that gamma is what you call a simple curve. Gamma is a simple curve. That means no self-intersections. Okay.
And again, why do I do that? Well, it's because if I had a self-intersection, then I could call this part gamma 1, this part, and I could call this part gamma 2, and then when I add them up, they will actually sum to the integral of the whole thing. So if the integral around this part is 0 and the integral around this part is 0, then when I sum them up, I mean, the integral along the whole thing is equal to the sum of the integrals around here and here, it will actually turn out to be 0. Okay? So this kind of arguments are very common in complex analysis. Also the argument where you go along a path and then you come back along the same path and they cancel out. And so that you can sort of glue together several things, several integrals in this way. Okay, but so I claim this. We can discuss why if it's not completely clear yet. And then can approximate gamma by what we call a polygon partitioning. I mean, so you approximate it by a polygon. Okay. So the polygon is called P. So you have this gamma here. And then you take take this zi, so you take, let me write this down properly. So you take this interval from the curve. So gamma, let's say, is defined on some interval. Let's say it's 0, 1, and into the disk. And then you subdivide this interval 0, 1 in many little pieces. So just like that. And then you put zi is equal to gamma of I over n, where I goes from 0 to n minus 1. Okay, so I get all these, and this is a good moment to use some color, I guess. So then you get all these points. So let's say that this is gamma of 0. You get this point z0, z1. Well, maybe I go in the other direction, actually. Z1, z2, z3, and so on. So you get all these points. And then you approximate gamma with this kind of polygon, OK? So of course, depending on how what is the shape of gamma, this could be a more or less good approximation at this level of refinement. But then, of course, you take these points closer and closer, so you can, by refining this partitioning more and more, you will come arbitrarily close to gamma. OK, so this will be the idea. So the idea is that, or the claim, is that the integral along P will approach the integral of gamma by refining the partition, which means that you take n larger and larger here, right? So you take more and more points closer and closer together on the boundary, and then this will hold. So what does this mean? So this means that it is enough to prove that the integral along our polygon is 0. Okay? So we get some polygon, and we need to prove that it's 0 here. And if we could do that, then also gamma would be 0, if this is true for any polygon, right? So this is what we want to prove. This is true for any polygon, not only a convex polygon, by the way. Okay, but then, in fact, it is my claim, so claim, that it's enough to prove even for a triangle. Where this delta is a triangle. It's a very good notation for a triangle because it is a triangle itself. So it is enough to prove, sorry, that this is equal to 0, of course, for delta a triangle. And what is the idea? I mean, the idea is easy to understand, and then we have to prove it rigorously. So the reason is that we can triangulate. So the reason is that we can triangulate any such polygon. And the technical term for such a polygon is an oriented simple closed polygon. In such a way, so this is a kind of key formulation here. So in such a way, so that all edges, so let me draw the picture actually. So let's say you have a polygon. What I want to do is to partition it in such a way so that any interior edge, any of these green edges here, are sides, or any of these green sides, are sides of exactly two triangles. And the only exception should be the sides that are already on the polygon, the sides of a polygon that are then in only one triangle. So I claim that this is possible to always do this, right? To find such a partitioning into triangles. So now I will complete the sentence that I was about to write, if I can find my paper, which is here. Okay, so that all sides are edges of exactly two triangles, except for the ones that are part, except for the sides on P, except for the sides that are part of the polygon P. Okay, so this is the claim. So the details of this thing are, I mean, all of the details are slightly outside of what I want to do. Yeah, so I will finish soon, but I don't know, I think we started like 10 minutes late or 15 minutes late because of this technical issue again. A lot of technical issues lately, last time as well. So the proof of this is by induction. So let me just remark. So proof is by induction, and by induction on the number of sides, okay, of the polygon. N, which is the number of sides of P, number of sides or edges of P. So the proof, so if N is equal to 3, then of course my polygon is a triangle, so it's completely trivial. So then it's okay. If N is equal to 4, then I have a polygon with 4 edges. Can I triangulate it in this way? Well, clearly, if I have 4 edges, the worst thing that can happen is, I guess, something like that. But then I can just triangulate it by dividing it in two. And I've got two triangles. And this interior edge is part of exactly two triangles. So n equals 4. This is obvious. Okay, and then for n larger than or equal to 5, or larger than or equal to 4, whatever you want. Of course, I need only one starting case. But anyway, the 4 case was so easy, I wanted to write it down anyway. And so in general, the claim is that it's always possible to, where is my eraser? By the way, if a polygon is convex, it's also completely obvious that you can do this. So the only question is, if you have many edges and the polygon is not convex, can you still do this thing? So the claim, so the only part that I said is slightly outside of what I want to give full details of today is just this claim. The rest I give details. So it is always, but you can believe this, I think, so it is always possible to find one diagonal of P. So diagonal means something like these green lines, OK? This is what I mean by a diagonal. That is interior to P, except for its endpoints. OK, so the claim is simply that if I had this picture, which I now solved, so to speak, I claim that whatever thing I draw, I can always find a diagonal that cuts these in two. So let's say I find this one. I could have taken any of these three. And then the point was, in the beginning, I had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 edges. And now I divided it into something that where each side now has less than 6 edges, OK? So this divides P into 2 polygons with at most n minus 1 sides. And then you apply the induction hypothesis, OK? So you assume that you could do it. So then you can do it for n minus 1 sides. And then you get the triangulation also for m. OK, and so there's just this claim that if you want to be really thorough, you have to prove such a claim. But OK. If you have any polygon, how do I find this diagonal that divides it into two? But OK, it's not very hard either. It's just that, you know, it's too many details about these polygons, which is not exactly the point. OK, so the idea is now that we have such a triangulation. And then the idea will be that it's enough, actually, to show that it's 0 on each of these triangles separately. And the reason for this is that you have to actually do this at least once. You have to see what happens when you add up all these triangles. So that the point will be that each of these interior edges, since they are part of exactly two triangles, they will be, you will pass over these twice. And because of the orientation, the way it is formed always counterclockwise, you will pass once in each direction, and they will cancel out. Okay, so we can see this. So, okay, my orientation on P is this way. P is the white edges on the outside. My orientation is this way. Now I take, I will want to go around each of the triangles once, counterclockwise. So I start with one of the triangles. Let me say this one. So I go like this, and then I go up here. Okay? So let me draw it like this, a green arrow. I go up. Now the turn comes to the next triangle. I want to go counterclockwise. So I go like this, I go up here, and then I come down here. Let me draw it in red, just to see that it went in the other direction. Now turn comes to this triangle, counterclockwise, like this. I go up, then I come down. And the final triangle, I go like this, and then I go down. And you see each of the interior edges, they went once in one direction, once in the other direction. So this is one edge, and this is then the opposite edge. And you know that the integral is then minus whatever the integral was in the other direction. So they will cancel out the integrals here. And on each of the edges on the outside, on P, you go in the correct direction exactly once. So when I sum up, so the point is that when I integrate, so I have these triangulations delta I, so the integral along P of f of z dz will be equal to the sum over I of the integral of these triangles delta I of f of z dz. Okay? Delta I is my triangulation. Delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, delta 4. In this simple example. Okay, so with this formula then, you can see that if I knew that along any triangle the integral was 0, then that's enough. Okay, and this is the lemma that remains then. So once we prove that, we have finished the proof of Cauchy's theorem for a disk. But this we will do next time, because the time is up. Okay? So I save this lemma for next time. Okay, so any questions about the course today, or about the homework, or anything else? Okay, so if not, then, so you're supposed to hand in the second homework today. And you all got your first homework back. And I think I got all the questions that people wanted to ask about that. If not, you can, of course, always send me emails. And, okay, and you are very busy next week, especially. You're always very busy. You're diploma students, but, yeah. Yeah, so I will consider maybe making some of the problems on the homework sheets. I mean, I'll give the same homework sheet I would have given, but I will allow you not to hand in all of the homeworks. I will choose which ones you should write carefully and which ones you should know. And yeah, I mean, you know from experience, of course, when the professor says that, he will test this by putting the ones that were not mandatory on the exam, right? So it's yeah. So I'm not saying I will do that, but you know, you never know. So you should learn them, you know, too, and make sure if you're not following the course, I mean, if you don't do them and you don't follow the course 2 weeks from now, then maybe you should go back and do them. Maybe that's what's why, you know, you never know. I'll think about doing that because the homeworks are not necessarily getting shorter. They are more or less the same length. And I want to give you the exercises because they each are supposed to teach you something. So I don't want to remove them. But what I can do is limit the number of homeworks that you have to actually write in a very detailed way. I mean, at least if it's going to be like last time. So the correction last time, as you noticed, was very harsh, you know. It wasn't on the level that, okay, let's see if you understood more or less what you're doing, and okay, if you do, then good. But the correction was more on the level of, okay, now we assume that you sat down for 1 week and you tried to write this very properly, and if you didn't write it 100%, we're gonna slash 80% of your points for this question. So with this philosophy, of course, I understand you cannot do it because you have too much work. So my idea is then that the ones that you don't have to hand in, you can do it, you know,
hand wave. You don't have to write it nice. You can write it just for yourself. But the ones, but then I give at least a few exercises where you can then take some care to write out the details and write it well, and then you can get some feedback on whether or not you actually catch all of the details or you would lose some little points in the margin, you know? So I think this is better, because if you have too many exercises and you have to write all of them, you know, I demand that all of them are completely perfect, then it's not really reasonable. So, because what I want is just for you to think about knowing how to more or less do them, and if I ask you to do any of the exercises perfectly, you would be able to do that one exercise perfectly, you know, but maybe not take time to do all of them very nicely written. So I'll try to do that. So I'll reduce the 7 to 4 maybe exercises that you have to handle. What's your usual bonus question? Yeah. No, so it's only the first homework that had this ultra hard bonus question, actually. Yeah. Yeah. No, very good. Very good. Yeah. But I also don't know. I mean, the people who are not here, who are virtually here, did you manage to collaborate anything on the homeworks or not? Because I guess you did. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, because I mean, obviously, this is a very unusual situation, and I just happened to notice that if you put the results on the homework, make a list from highest to lowest, the 5 highest are the 5 that are here, and the 5 lowest are the ones that are not here. So there is some correlation going on. Like, I could imagine easily that, of course, it's an advantage to be here. You can more easily talk to each other and so on. So. Just out of concern for the people who are not here. No, could be nice to see. Maybe they need some extra discussion time, or I don't know, something like that. Okay, so you're free to go. Thanks. See you on Friday. Yeah, and if you want, you can hand in the homework to me now. You prefer. But you can also keep it until before the tutorial.